The next item of business is a debate on motion 7093 in the name of Mary McCallan on COP27 outcomes. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson to speak to and to move the motion around 13 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today's debate addresses one of the most important challenges facing not just Scotland but the international community. The latest report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change painted a stark picture about the damage human beings are causing to the planet. They stated that climate change is already causing widespread disruption in every region in the world. The 1.1 degrees centigrade of warming is resulting in droughts, extreme heat, and record floods. There are estimates that in the next decade, climate change will drive anywhere between 32 and 132 million more people into extreme poverty. Global warming will jeopardise food security as well as increase heat-related mortality and other serious issues. We are on a journey where risk will escalate quickly, with higher temperatures often causing irreversible impact of climate change. Inequity, conflict and development challenges heighten vulnerability to climate risk, as well as climate changes increasing the risk of conflict and exacerbating existing inequalities. While we are vulnerable, it is clear that those who have contributed the least to climate change are suffering the worst of its impact. In Scotland, we have taken urgent action. Our targets set out in the 2019 Climate Change Act and voted overwhelmingly in this chamber is to be net zero by 2045. We have known from the start that achieving this level of ambition would not be easy, and meeting the targets will require a whole of society effort. But we also know that the cost of inaction greatly outweighs the cost of acting. We must do all we can now for generations to come. There are no easy options left for us to avoid catastrophic impact. We must now take the difficult decisions needed for Scotland to do its part, protecting Scottish people and acting in solidarity with those facing loss and damage from climate change across the world. The transition to net zero is not just an environmental imperative, but an economic opportunity, one where Scotland can become world-leading and secure first-mover advantage in key areas. ScotWind, for example, represents the world's largest commercial round for floating offshore wind. We are embracing the opportunity presented by net-zero technologies such as renewable energy and the hydrogen economy, prioritising our world-renowned natural capital and building a sustainable and inclusive economy that is resilient to future shocks. More than happy to give way.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you. I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary giving me. Speaking to businesses, Cabinet Secretary, what they say is the public support from governments, i.e. both governments in Scotland, is difficult to access. What can the Scottish Government do to ensure that the investment available there reaches those companies that really require to push this new technology forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, it depends on the type of technology and area in which they are working. So, for example, if it is looking to help to support inward investment opportunities, it could be through SDI and Scottish Enterprise on the Highlands, the Highlands and Islands Enterprise, or through the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency. So it depends on whether it's an inward investment opportunity or an expansion opportunity. But there are relevant bodies that can provide them with support if they are looking at expanding their work in these areas of technology. But if the member has some specific examples he wants to share with me, I'm more than happy to take that information away and ensure he gets a more detailed response. But, Presiding Officer, we cannot meet the climate crisis alone. It is a global challenge that requires us to work together as a global community with a shared sense of urgency. The two annual United Nations conferences of parties, both COP27 on climate last month in Egypt and COP15 on biodiversity in Montreal starting tomorrow, are key moments for the international community to come together to build consensus, to commit to taking action, and importantly, to hold each other to account. Over 100 heads of states and governments and 35,000 participants attended COP27, and negotiations finished 2 days later than planned, making this international gathering in Sharm el-Sheikh one of the longest and largest COPs ever held. The agenda at COP was packed with opportunities to strengthen and deepen relationships to tackle climate change and for the wider benefit of Scotland. During COP27, the First Minister and the Minister for Environment and Land Reform held bilateral meetings with a significant number of different parties. This included ministers from across the world and other key stakeholders. Additionally, building on our work in Glasgow's COP26, we committed to providing a platform to the voices of those traditionally underrepresented at COP events. In order to take this further forward, ministers, including the First Minister, met with a range of representatives from youth organisations and civil organisations, particularly those from the Global South. There was a huge interest in our transition here in Scotland to renewables, in particular on offshore wind and in green hydrogen, spaces in which Scotland is seen as a world leader. We shared our pioneering model for a just transition. We also used COP to urge our partners to prioritise, as far as possible, an approach to energy security that focuses on sustainability with measures to promote energy efficiency and to accelerate the development of renewable and low-carbon energy. We want to, if I can make a little bit further progress, please. So what we did at COP27, or what did COP27 achieve? COP27 has seen the clearest acknowledgement to date that the people least responsible for global warming are often the ones suffering the worst consequences. And it's fundamentally a matter of human rights. This recognition led to a watershed agreement at COP27 to establish a global fund for loss and damage to provide financial assistance to developing countries most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. Questions around who will pay into this fund and who will be able to draw from it will still have to be answered, and clearly much remains to be resolved. But despite this, the agreement alone is a hugely important achievement after 30 years of lobbying by leaders from countries and communities worst impacted by climate change. It is these leaders, through their tenacity and resolve, that lies behind this particular breakthrough. Particular recognition must go to Pakistan's climate minister, Sherry Rehman, who the First Minister met with at COP, for her ability to bring parties together on the issue and put forward a meaningful proposal on behalf of the G77 and China negotiating group. Last year, Scotland became the first global north government in the world to announce funding to address loss and damage, and we have now increased our commitment to £7 million. As one of the first movers, our action has helped catalyse a total of over $300 million in international pledges, which demonstrates the progress that has been made in just 1 year. We also helped keep the focus on the practicalities of funding loss and damage, for which we set the scene at our October Loss and Damage Conference, focusing on practical action. The report from this conference was referenced throughout COP and used to inform the negotiations. How to fund loss and damage in such a way that meets the needs of the most vulnerable communities will be debated over the next year and beyond as negotiators seek to put the COP27 loss and damage agreement into practice. However, alongside this success, it is deeply disappointing that the recognition of loss and damage has not been matched by greater action in preventing a worsening of the climate crisis. Keeping 1.5 alive and delivering the fastest possible transition away from fossil fuels is key to preventing greater loss and damage in the future. And it is simply not good enough that countries failed to make progress on that agenda, and that there has been such a strong pushback on action we all know is needed if 1.5 degrees is to remain truly within our reach. I'll give way to the member.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful because the Cabinet Secretary is making some very important points. If I can bring it back to just transition, because it's a really important issue. In the closing plenary session of COP27, there was considerable support for fossil fuel phase-out from both the UK, the US and indeed the EU. But here in Scotland, he'll be aware that Stop Climate Chaos Scotland are asking for further clarity from Scottish Government about its policies on fossil fuels, including a target date for phase-out and measures to ensure a just transition in its forthcoming energy strategy. Is Minister meeting with the Coalition to discuss these points and make such commitments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, the member raises an important point, and we've set out very clearly our position on the continued extraction of fossil fuels, and the unabated continued extraction of them is not being compatible with achieving the principles of the Paris Agreement. And it's important that we take forward measures that help to retain those key principles within the Paris Agreement. And I can assure the member that when we publish our Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan in the coming weeks, we will set out very clearly how we intend to take that forward here in Scotland. But the member will also recognise that the key powers to make decisions in these matters remain reserved to the government in London, which is why I think in order to make further progress in these matters, we need to have these powers here in the Scottish Parliament. And is there, can I'll give way to the member, sign off, so I'm keen to try and finish off within the
Liam
time scale.
I'm genuinely grateful, Cabinet Secretary. I read at the weekend that the possible future SNP leader in Westminster, Stephen Flynn, described Nicola Sturgeon's opposition to new North Sea oil and gas fields as crazy. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with Stephen Flynn or Nicola Sturgeon?
Cabinet Secretary.
I haven't saw such a quote from Stephen Flynn, and if that is the case, then Stephen Flynn's clearly entitled to his view, but as I'm sure the member is wise enough to recognise, is that you shouldn't always necessarily believe everything that he reads in the newspapers. It is, of course, Presiding Officer, vitally important that countries recommit themselves to doing everything that they can to ensure that we keep 1.5 alive and to build a coalition ahead of COP28 that protects and drives progress against any further pushback. COP27 cover decision included mention for the first time of nature-based solutions, but otherwise there was little recognition of the need to tackle the twin crises of climate and nature together. We need nature to mitigate the effects of climate change, and nature needs us to manage climate change in order to avoid its collapse. This has to be reflected in outcomes of both the climate and biodiversity COPs. COP15, the biodiversity COP, begins tomorrow in Montreal, and it's vitally important that nations reach an ambitious global agreement on the protection and restoration of nature. I've highlighted, Presiding Officer, this afternoon that while we have made progress, there is still much, much more to do. We need to work collectively to meet the international climate change challenge. The Scottish Government will be turning its attention now to making good on the opportunities that COP27 has provided. The global community will be doing the same. While much remains to be decided about how and who of the funding yet to be established for Loss and Damage Fund, it was a genuine success and a rare positive news story. Nevertheless, COP27 came to a close with too many of the big decisions being referred to a later date. The goal to limit change to 1.5 remains worryingly distant. We know that women and girls are disproportionately impacted by the climate crisis. That's why Scotland has committed further funding to strengthen women's participation in climate change policy and in decision making. But with negotiations on gender closing without any resolution, we are still no closer to addressing one of the fundamental inequalities of the climate crisis. COP27, Presiding Officer, should energise our ambition at home and abroad, and I very much look forward to hearing the contributions from across the chamber here this afternoon, and I move the motion in Mary McCallum's name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Liam Kerr to speak to and to move Amendment 7093.2. Around 9 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And if I may pick up where the Cabinet Secretary left off, there is no doubt that COP27 didn't have perhaps the groundbreaking commitments of COP26. But that's not to say that it wasn't a success, because it did close with a, quote, breakthrough agreement, the Sharm el-Sheikh implementation plan, in which nations reaffirmed their commitment to keep 1.5 alive. They strengthened their resolve to cut emissions and boosted support for finance, technology and capacity building in developing countries. And the UK showed further leadership at COP27. They announced more than £100 million to support developing countries dealing with climate change impacts, tripling funding for adaptation projects to £1.5 billion by 2025, and committing £11.6 billion in international climate change funding. But COP27 was never going to match COP26. Indeed, Professor Peter Thorne, one of the lead authors of the UN report that warned of a code red for humanity, said COP27 was always going to be more of a technical summit. These COPs have a natural rhythm, and it's only every 4 to 6 years where major progress is expected. Intervening COPs achieve much less tangible progress. But what is crucial at any COP is that agreements and announcements are credible and deliverable. So the motion rightly lauds the agreement between the parties to establish a loss and damage fund. And as the Cabinet Secretary flagged, the First Minister tried to preempt that by suggesting Scotland would put £5 million into its own loss and damage fund. Yet, when I asked Minister McCallum a few weeks ago what are the eligibility criteria, the application process and the defined outcomes, she replied they're still designing it. Later, responding to my written question, she confirmed decisions on how the £5 million loss and damage funding will be allocated are yet to be taken. And it turns out the £2 million scheme they announced at COP26, mentioned in the motion, hasn't even been fully allocated yet. It's almost easier, Presiding Officer, as if it's easier to produce sound bites than it is to produce hard data and action. On which note, whilst it is absolutely right of the Cabinet Secretary to mention COP15, some might feel it brave for the government motion to demand action on the protection of the seas, when last month they told me that they won't respond to the Eclair Committee's report on regional marine planning until early in 2023, a report that was published in December 2020. And don't forget, as the Cabinet Secretary flagged, this is a government which in 2018 put over 200 policies and proposals into a climate change plan to achieve net zero by 2045 and updated it in 2020. But he forgot to mention that when I asked earlier this year how much it will cost to achieve, he told me the government doesn't yet know. Presiding Officer, what the COPs do show us is that we have to strive towards accurate data. We cannot allow differing political visions or dogma to misinform the public, as of course that risks eroding trust. Which means that when Mark Ruskell, as an MSP in a party of government, criticises the COP27 agreement for lacking any phase-out or even a phase-down of all fossil fuels, or Mary McCallum says, we do not agree with the UK government issuing new oil and gas licences, they've got to go on to address the fact that Britain's electricity mix over the last 4 weeks, now remember, that's the power that keeps us heated, keeps our lights on, charges our EVs, keeps our cookers working, was gas 44.8%, wind 23.7%, nuclear 14.1%, solar, hydro and biomass 10.2%. Now, we already know that the Scottish Government won't allow any new nuclear to be built in Scotland. And we also know from the quotes I gave and the text of the motion that the SNP and Greens want to stop North Sea gas production. But it is blindingly obvious that there is no way renewables can replace these anytime soon, in which case this government is basically proposing to satisfy our gas needs by importing from places like Qatar, which has 2 to 3 times the carbon emissions of that pulled up from the North Sea, even before INTOG happens. Exactly. Yes.
Audrey Nicol.
giving way. Just in relation to the point you're making, the member's making in relation to production of renewable energy, by the same token, it would be very difficult and it would take us a considerable amount of time to increase North Sea oil and gas production. That just doesn't happen overnight. And I'm not sure if it's totally accurate to say, use the word stopping production. My understanding is we're seeking a gradual decline.
Liam Kerr.
Well, I thank the member for the intervention. That rather contradicts with the quotes that I put up earlier. But the point is that I think we all want to see a just transition, because the cost to the up to the 100,000 workers in or connected to the oil industry, oil and gas industry, around 70,000 of whom are located in Scotland, would be considerable if we were to stop right now. We all agree that there needs to be a just transition, as mentioned in the Labour amendment, but that requires us to work with our North Sea industries, not against them. And so without BP putting around £12 billion by 2030 into offshore wind, hydrogen, EV charge points and carbon capture, without Total Energies ploughing over half its R&D budget into pioneering new energies and reducing environmental footprint, without Shell investing between £15 and £20 billion into low and zero carbon products and services, without Neptune Energy achieving gold status by the UN's environmental programme for their plans to reduce methane emissions, that transition simply isn't going to happen. I'll take Monica Lennon's intervention.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful to Liam Kerr. I know that he takes climate emergency very seriously, but can I ask, on that aspiration around just transition, we must make real, if the Rosebank oil field goes ahead, how does that help a just transition?
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful, and she's right. The member is right, of course. I do take it very seriously indeed, as I know does she. And that's why she'll be interested to know that we have to set Rosebank in the context of the bigger picture and that transition that she rightly talks about. I go back to the point about where we get our supply from and the point about keeping it domestic. I also point out that Rosebank is projected to be worth over £8 billion over its lifetime to the domestic UK economy, and there are wider economic benefits worth over £24 billion. And at its peak, it will create 1,600 UK-based jobs. And of course, I know, and the member's concerned about this, but don't forget that Rosebank production emissions will be significantly lower than imports of LNG from across the world, such as Qatar, that I mentioned earlier. And, Presiding Officer, that striving for accuracy, will I have time at the end, Presiding Officer?
A wee bit of time.
I beg your pardon, sir?
The member will have a wee bit of time.
A wee bit of time, if the member is very quick.
Gillian Martin.
I'm very grateful to Liam Kerr. I think one of the issues that I have with this sort of debate is about oil and gas. It's about how we extract it, and you're lowering the emissions of how we produce it and extract it. But we fundamentally have to make a differentiation between what the oil and gas is used for. We need to stop burning oil and gas. That's the real elephant in the room. It's not the production of it, it's the burning of it.
Liam Kerr.
I think that's actually a very fair point and well made. And I think the member's point goes towards how we present data, how we put information out into the public realm. And I think that is key, because what we must do is things like the First Minister needs to not be blithely saying when speaking about this area that under this government we have a position where our net energy consumption is already provided by renewable energy sources, when anyone who actually knows or has bothered to inform themselves about the UK's energy mix can say that is demonstrably and evidentially false. And it means not claiming that Scotland has 25% of Europe's offshore wind potential, when ministers had known for years that was not and never had been accurate. Yeah. And that's particularly egregious given that ministers Sturgeon, Swinney, Todd, McPherson, Robertson, Slater and Matheson have all put that out knowingly. And even the SNP MPs, Cowan, Hendry, Blackford and Oswald, have trotted it out, including one MP who's thrown out this unevidenced, unresearched, misleading data not once, not twice, but five times in a public forum, including the Houses of Parliament, is putative new leader Stephen Flynn, MP. Presiding Officer, there is so much more to say on COP27, but time is short. My colleagues will look to address other aspects of the motion and amendments. But, Presiding Officer, Perhaps COP27 wasn't as monumental as the UK-led COP26, but as we've heard from the UN itself, that is to be expected. And what it does show, like all COPs, is that the climate emergency doesn't recognise borders. This is a global issue which will only be addressed by global action in which we all work together. Indeed, the UN said that COP27 would be held with, quote, an appreciation of the value of multilateral, collective and concerted action as the only means to address this truly global threat. Now, in a rare moment of accuracy, on Saturday, Mr. Patrick Harvey was quoted as saying, the whole world is behind the curve on climate. Unusually, he's right, and the solution must therefore be to recognise what has been achieved, to ensure that governments strive to use accurate, evidenced data, to avoid putting up borders which just divide our collective efforts, and to work together to keep 1.5 alive. Yeah. That's why I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Could I remind all members, please, who are wishing to speak in the debate to ensure that they have, in fact, pressed the request to speak button. Thank you. I now call on Colin Smith to speak to and to move amendment 7093.1. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Smith.
President Officer, despite some modest steps forward in loss and damage support for climate vulnerable countries at COP27, we didn't see the transformative leap we urgently needed. The UN tells us that new pledges agreed in Egypt will take just 1% off global emissions in 2030. And far from keeping 1.5 degrees alive, we're heading for a catastrophic 2.8 degrees. Our planet is hotter than it has been for 125,000 years, yet our world leaders fiddle while the world burns. And despite the admirable efforts of COP26 President Alex Sharma, there was little leadership from Prime Minister Rishi Sunak, whose most memorable act was to eventually decide to turn up. But just as we needed leadership abroad at COP27, more than ever, we need leadership here at home. Whether it's the devastating floods in Pakistan or Britain's first 40 degrees days, the accelerating climate crisis affects every one of us abroad and here at home. I've no doubt that the government have chosen to have this debate before the Climate Change Committee publish their assessment tomorrow on our progress to net zero here in Scotland. I think that tells its own story about what the government know that report card is likely to say, a combination of fails and could do better. Take the three big emitters, starting with the largest source of greenhouse gas emissions, transport. It's responsible for a third of our emissions, with levels barely below those of 1990. We only met our emissions target in 2020 because a pandemic stopped all of us travelling. Yet as we face that post-pandemic rebound back to car use, the Scottish Government's response has been to axe 240 trains a day. That's 90,000 a year. They've also still not given councils the powers as secure in the Transport Bill and, more importantly, the resources they need to set up and run their own local bus services. At a time, our bus network has been dismantled route by route and bus fares rise and rise. We've seen bus passenger numbers fall by 25% since 2007-08. That's 121 million fewer passenger journeys, and fares have risen by nearly 19% in the past 5 years alone. And on electric vehicles, the Climate Change Committee estimates we'll need at least 30,000 public electric vehicle charging points in Scotland by 2030, yet the government's own target is just over 4,000 in the next few years. Where is the leadership at home on transport? I'll take an intervention from Mr. Whitley.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for the member taking an intervention. Would you agree with me that the drag on producing electric vehicle charging points is preventing us moving to electric vehicles?
Colin Smith.
I absolutely do agree with that point. And recently, the BBC Dispatches programme also showed that of those charging points that we already have, a quarter of them don't even work. There's no incentive there for many communities, particularly those in rural areas, yet to move towards electric vehicles. And what about heating in buildings? How does the decision by the Scottish Government to cut the energy efficiency budget by £133 million instead of tackling why the poorly designed schemes are not being utilised show leadership, when we have a shameful level of fuel poverty in Scotland, and we know that properly insulating our homes not only cuts fuel bills, but it cuts fuel use and therefore our emissions. And on the third big emitter, agriculture and land, progress still does not go far enough. It's 6 years since the EU referendum. The clock is ticking towards the end of the transition period, and it's ticking when it comes to meeting our climate commitments. The only clock that seems to have stopped since 2016 has been the government's when it comes to laying out what post-Brexit agricultural support will look like. We've had dither, we've had delay. What we haven't had is the detail, the direction, the support our farmers and crofters need to properly plan and make the changes. That's not climate leadership. And, Presiding Officer, even in those areas where we have made good progress in cutting emissions, energy production, and I recognise the significant progress in renewable energy, we fail to show the leadership needed to deliver the jobs-led just transition we need. The Scottish Government's low-carbon economic strategy in 2010 promised 130,000 renewable jobs by 2020. We were told we'd be the Saudi Arabia of renewables. Yet the recent Fraser of Allender Institute's report estimated the number of renewable jobs created was just a fifth, 27,000. When we consider which sectors can tackle Scotland's woeful economic growth, that can create that greener, fairer country with good, secure jobs wherever people live in the country, all roads do lead to renewables. Our net zero targets are not a barrier to economic growth, they are actually the path towards it. The long-term answer to the energy bills crisis, to the climate crisis, to deliver that jobs growth is not a dash for gas, but a sprint for homegrown clean energy. But we don't just need to keep speeding up the race for renewables. For example, properly resourcing Marine Scotland and our council's planning department so the consenting process recognises the urgency. We need to also spread the benefits. We can't repeat the mistakes of the past, which meant none of the wind turbines, carpet and much of our countryside are even manufactured here in Scotland. We need a proper industrial strategy with clear targets. 100% clean energy, 12 gigawatts of additional onshore wind by 2030, 11 gigawatts of offshore wind, 4 to 6 gigawatts of solar capacity, with a clear energy route, with a clear timeline for that steady stream of work to give supply chain companies the confidence to invest, with the backing of government investment in Scottish ports and Scottish skills and Scottish factories, so those supply chain jobs come to Scottish firms. That's why Labour has consistently called for every penny raised from the ScotWind leasing round to be ring-fenced for a renewables fund to invest in making our supply chains ready to deliver. The Scottish Government have offshored Scotland's wind on the cheap. We cannot afford to also offshore the jobs. And, Presiding Officer, we shouldn't be offshoring the profits either to largely overseas-owned multinationals. That's why Labour also supports the establishment of a publicly owned energy firm to invest in technology and jobs of the future. It's what Labour in Wales are doing, it's what the next UK Labour government will do, and it's what the SNP and Greens used to want to do, but no longer support that. Presiding Officer, the lack of world leadership at COP27 should make us all even more determined to show more leadership here at home. We may have ambitious targets, cutting emissions by three quarters by 2030, net zero by 2045, but those targets are meaningless if they are missed targets. So Labour will support the government's motion today, but in moving the amendment in my name, we are urging Parliament to show leadership, to recognise that we do not yet have the plan, the urgent actions needed to properly play our part in stopping this climate crisis also becoming a climate catastrophe.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Smith. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton, who joins us remotely for around 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak for the Scottish Liberal Democrats on this important debate, and I thank Mary McCallan and the Scottish Government for securing time for it in the Chamber. When referencing the environment, the late South African bishop and theologian Desmond Tutu once said that 25 years ago, people could be excused for not knowing much or doing much about climate change, but today we have no excuse. And in this, the year that he passed, those words ring really true. Indeed, it goes without saying that the climate crisis is perhaps the most pressing issue of our time. So it is right that leaders from across the world come together through COP to put the collective shoulder to the wheel. And to be sure, as others have noted today, there is some things to be praised in the outcome of the latest conference, and much indeed to be praised, including a global methane cut, pledged to cut emissions by 30% by 2030, and the establishment of a global loss and damage to support the countries set to be worst affected by climate change, and we have heard much of that in the debate so far this afternoon. However, the promised action still falls short of what is needed if we are to effectively combat the global climate challenge. And as the Scottish Government's motion rightly notes, it is disappointing that agreement could not be reached on extending promises on the phase down of coal use. This in itself, an unhappy compromise at the last conference, at COP, of the ideal of phasing coal out altogether to other fossil fuel types as well. Goals for cutting back on fossil fuel use has, of course, been hindered by the world around us, particularly by the conflict in Ukraine. Though this indeed only seems to underline the need to move away from our dependence on oil and gas. Our energy security depends on that. It now seems increasingly likely that the dream of keeping 1.5 alive is sadly dead on arrival, with estimates indicating that to achieve this, we would need to halve global emissions by 2030. That's a goal well beyond the aspirations of the largest emitting nations and beyond practical reality of many others besides. However, this obviously does not mean that all hope is lost or that we should give up now. Every fraction of a degree of warming that we can avoid results in a better outcome for our humanity and our planet. Presiding officer, before COP began, I said that Scotland needed new hope when it comes to tackling this climate emergency. We need decisive and tangible action, not just promises, but radical, credible policies that will drive down Scotland's emissions. And it must be said that there is much to welcome in the Scottish Government's and this Parliament's attitude to climate policy, the reach of its ambitions. We should be proud of the ambitious target to reduce emissions by 75% by 2030, passed into law through the work in part of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. And welcome is the attention already given to areas such as biodiversity, to renewables, to energy production and heating. However, there remains a considerable value action gap between the Scottish Government's rhetoric and the promise made of its world-leading targets and the reality of its actions. Scotland met its emissions reductions for the first and so far only time in 2020 in the context of a national lockdown when everybody was at home, leaving the distinct impression that COVID has done more to curb emissions than this government has managed so far. Last year, the Climate Change Committee assessed that the most of the key policy levers are now in the hands of the Scottish Government, but promises have not yet turned to action. The committee's latest Scottish Progress report comes out tomorrow, and I fear that the review will not be much improved. The government's aims for retrofitting buildings are admirable and could, in theory, drive down emissions while improving ordinary people's quality of life, stimulating the economy and creating new work opportunities. There's still no answer on how Scotland is to meet the £31 billion gap between the heat and building strategies, expected cost and the funding promise. And it may be unsurprising then that the retrofitting rollout has so far been woeful. And there's with Scottish Liberal Democrat research indicating that at the current rate, just insulating Scotland's fuel poor households could take in and of itself 300 years. The ScotWind offshore leasing deals, as Colin Smith rightly mentioned, were heralded by the Scottish Government as revolutionising Scotland's energy sector. But they've resulted in Scotland's natural resources being sold off on the cheap while under delivering on supply chain promises. With no phasing, there will be insufficient capacity in the Scottish sector to deliver on those projects. And really, the Scottish Government should not have applied the cap as we've discussed previously. Meanwhile, even though we know it will add some 600,000 tonnes of CO2 to Scotland's carbon footprint, the Scottish Government continues to doggedly support its Heathrow Airport expansion deal. Presiding officer, all of this leaves the inescapable feeling that the environmentalism of the SNP Green Government is half-hearted, distracted, and comes a distant second to its goal of driving forward with independence. More than ever, we need to urgently address Scotland's role in climate change. If we are to meaningfully achieve a just transition, this moment calls for focused attention, dramatic action, not promises and platitudes. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Cole Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call point of order, John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can you clarify if we are able to intervene on remote speakers or how we do that?
Mr. Mason, I was intrigued, as you were, as to why it didn't appear to be flashing on Mr. Cole Hamilton's screen. You should be able to make interventions on remote speakers. It hasn't functioned, I don't think, in this instance, as it should be, but we'd have to investigate that further. But thank you for your point of order. And I call point of order, Cabinet Secretary.
Can I just check, just further to your comments there, are we checking at the present moment that if there's anyone else joining remotely, that we are in a position where we can intervene on them if we seek to do so, and that they will be aware that there's someone in the chamber who's trying to intervene on them?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That is what we're checking. I'm not aware of other colleagues who are intending to participate remotely, but whether it's for this debate or future business, the Parliament would want to make sure that the system is working as it's intended to do. Thank you. As I say, we'll proceed with the opening with the open speakers. Firstly, Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Graeme Simpson for around 6 minutes. Ms. Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It hardly seems like a year since Glasgow played host to the COP26 climate conference and welcomed world leaders, environmentalists, young people and many others invested in protecting our climate and our planet. And in April, the IPCC warned it was now or never to limit global warming. Successes at COP26 included the signing of the Glasgow Climate Pact and development of the Paris Agreement rulebook, providing guidance on how the Paris Agreement is delivered. 12 months on, Egypt has just hosted COP27 in the resort of Sharm el-Sheikh. And against the difficult backdrop of an unprecedented cost of living and energy crisis and Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine, COP27 restated the global commitment to tackling climate change. Progress included a focus on food security for the first time, highlighting the importance of safeguarding food supply. And only this morning, the NFU stated that the UK is walking into a food supply crisis under a perfect storm of low yields, supply challenges and soaring energy costs, bearing down on farmers across the UK. And there was a renewed focus on finance, mobilising private finance as a key aspect of global action. However, the most important breakthrough focused on climate impacts, recognising climate change is already adversely affecting many countries and threatens increasing damage and destruction with every additional increment of warming. COP27 is seen by many to have been the COP that will go down in history as the UN Climate Change Conference where the Breakthrough Loss and Damage Fund was agreed. And as the First Minister outlined in her speech during a loss and damage panel, the nations that suffer the worst loss and damage continue to be the nations that have done the least, in some cases virtually nothing, to cause the problem of climate change in the first place. The Loss and Damage Fund will assist climate vulnerable countries to address impacts which cannot or have not been adapted to. And this important breakthrough demonstrates real progress. However, it's only the beginning of a difficult process. Key agreements are still needed on which countries will contribute to the fund, how much each country will pay, and which countries will be able to benefit. COP27 made clear that discussions on support must run parallel with dialogue on how to both mitigate the impact and protect against climate change through adaptations. So there is much work to do. The Climate Change Committee report, COP27 Key Outcomes and Next Steps for the UK, sets out the economic damage, such as destruction to property, and the non-economic damage, such as loss of cultural heritage, that is already affecting communities, ecosystems and businesses. The devastating floods in Pakistan and Nigeria, drought-induced famines in Somalia, and who couldn't avoid the intense heat waves in Europe this summer, all testament to the impact already bearing down on us all. But what can a small nation like Scotland realistically achieve in the context of a global climate crisis? Well, I'm delighted Scotland was the first nation to pledge financial support to address loss and damage. And I'm aware Scotland saw huge interest at COP27 in our renewables sector. I will.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Just on that £5 million loss and damage fund, that is only a quarter of the £20 million earmarked for independence. Can the member understand why perhaps people might feel the Scottish Government has got its priorities wrong?
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for his intervention, but I think that's a discussion for a different day. I'm concentrating on COP27. At home, our ambitious net zero targets mean we all face hard choices. How we travel, heat our homes, source our food. Our focus is now rightly on renewable energy and emerging green technologies, and already wind power is the cheapest form of power in our energy mix. Our expertise in oil and gas is an opportunity to deliver our just transition, not just because it's an environmental imperative, but a significant economic opportunity. In my constituency, just transition is literally everywhere, a pivotal part of our local economy, our landscape, and our future prosperity. Frustratingly for the North East, however, the UK government's questionable decision-making and woeful political instability is hugely detrimental to the North East. Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce recently reported half of companies surveyed for their latest energy transition report said the current political and regulatory environment was a barrier to diversification. And the uncertainty over the Acorn CCUS project and lack of commitment shown to this vitally important project by the UK is just one example.
Gillian,
time?
I can give you the time back, Ms Nicholl.
I just wanted to flag up to Audrey Nicholl that us meeting our Climate Change Act commitments is actually dependent on CCUS actually being implemented, and that we as a country won't actually reach them until the UK government acts on Acorn and Scottish Cluster.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for raising that hugely valid point, and I note, because I've read a little bit about CCUS and because of its relevance to my constituency, that the only body that seems to be dragging its feet on CCUS is the UK government, who are essentially dimming the lights on our local energy industry. So given the £400 billion or so of tax revenue that's flowed to the UK Treasury from Scotland over many decades, I urge the Scottish Government to press the UK Government to honour their commitment to Scotland's just transition and tackling global climate change. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, I am immensely proud of Scotland's ambition, leadership and commitment to COP27, the Global South and tackling global climate change. And I look forward to monitoring progress and playing my part within my constituency and beyond to ensure Scotland becomes greener, cleaner and net zero. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. I can inform the Chamber we are now pretty much out of time, so any interventions will have to be accommodated within speaking allocations. I call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Rona Mackay for up to 6 minutes. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've taken part in debates on COP26 and COP27, both looking back and looking forward. And after COP26, it looked as though 1.5 might still be alive. More than 100 countries signed a pledge to halt and reverse deforestation. At least 40 countries agreed to stop using coal, while leaders signed a pledge to cut methane emissions by 30% by 2030. I guess there was some hope. We could look at the positives. But I've got to be honest, these COP events look to me like junkets for world leaders and people like Susan Aitken, and they don't appear to change anything. And after COP27, I'm not filled with hope. As the Climate Change Committee notes, while the summit restated the global commitment to tackling climate change in the face of the current energy crisis, global emissions remain at record high levels, and the world is on track to warming well in excess of 2 degrees C. I can't see that much has been achieved by Nicola Sturgeon attending either, and even less by a delegation from Glasgow City Council flying to Egypt. And I'll take the intervention.
Gillian Martin.
I just wanted to point out that if Susan Aitken's role to go over there was to talk about COP26 and the actual young people's participation, the people from deprived areas involved in COP26, and she was invited over there to do the same at COP27. And I would also make the point that if Nicola Sturgeon hadn't been there, we probably wouldn't have had any outcomes from COP27, particularly in loss and damage.
Graham Simpson, led by the Scottish Government.
Well, Deputy Presiding Officer, listen, I'm sure Miss Aitken had a wonderful time, but I don't see that she's achieved very much. Today's debate should have been held tomorrow, because that's when we'll hear from the Climate Change Committee on how Scotland is actually doing. And you can be fairly certain it will not be a glowing report. For while there's been progress in decarbonising our electricity supply, there's been precious little in industry, transport, the biggest emitter, as we've already heard, and buildings. So I'm going to talk about transport. The SNP Scottish Government has a rather lofty ambition to cut car mileage by 20% by 2030, just over 7 years away. That target was introduced in their climate change plan update of 2020. Now, if you're going to set such a target and have any hope of reaching it, then you're going to have to do some pretty unpopular things, like hitting people hard in the pocket, which is presumably why the SNP have not come up with any actual policies to trigger a change from gas-guzzling private vehicles. And you'll note, Presiding Officer, that the target is just for cars, not vans, and certainly not lorries. But thankfully, we have the UK government leading on efforts to decarbonise lorries, with Glasgow firm HVS being awarded £30 million to develop technology which could see lorries run on hydrogen. Yep. It's pretty obvious that if you want people to ditch their cars, then you will need to provide an alternative, unless we want a nation of hermits. Now, that might appeal to the Greens, but in the real world, it should mean creating a comprehensive, joined-up and cheap public transport system of the kind we can only dream of. The so-called Fair Fares Review is nowhere to be seen. When it does appear, there will be thousands of words of government waffle, but I can tell whichever minister here wants to listen, it can be boiled down to just two: lower fares, and maybe another two, for all. That might get people onto buses and trains, but it will take more than lower fares. Having routes that connect communities, rural and urban, is vital, but we have too many public transport deserts. So we should be helping councils to use the powers they now have to organise bus services. And we should be looking at train routes too, dueling tracks like the East Kilbride line. We should use technology to have multi-mode smart cards. And we should treat ferries as buses and offer free travel to under 22s who live on the islands. Going back to that 2030 cars target, there's no point banning the sale of diesel and petrol cars if the infrastructure to replace them isn't there. Correct. We're a long way off having the number of electric vehicle charges required to produce a sea change. According to Charge Place Scotland, there are 2,400 chargers in Scotland, but with a target of 30,000 by 2030, we need to install about 400 a month. Last month, we managed 8. Not 800, 8. And of course, we know that many of them don't work. There's much more to do with buses too, and our ageing ferries are gas guzzlers with no sign of decarbonising the fleet anytime soon. Presiding Officer, the Climate Change Committee report tomorrow will make interesting reading, as did their UK-wide report, also published this month. It talks about how targets are still not matched by actions. Presiding Officer, for me, we shouldn't be patting ourselves on the back here. The world is not acting fast enough on climate change, and I'm afraid that includes Scotland.
Thank you. We now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are in the midst of a global climate emergency, of that there is no doubt, and the need for radical action to save the planet from further damage is understood and agreed by countries throughout the world. However, we are playing catch-up after decades of neglect and denial on all fronts. And after the promises made and optimism shown at COP26 in Glasgow last year by most countries, there is a palpable sense of disappointment that COP27 in Egypt was unable to build on that progress and that the 1.5 degree target was in danger of being ebbed away until contested. However, despite this disappointment and major concern about the lack of progress, I'm proud that Scotland, unlike Graham Simpson, has agreed to establish a fund for loss and damage to smaller countries bearing the brunt of the devastating effects of climate change. Scotland's the first developed country ever to make a financial contribution and make this commitment. Presiding Officer, this is truly... Yes.
Liam Kerr.
I just wonder, given the point I made earlier about the fact that there are no details, there are no outcomes, there are no criteria for that loss and damage fund, when she expects her government to put that out?
Rona Mackay.
Yeah, I'm absolutely confident that those details will come out soon, and the fact that the commitment's been made is something to be celebrated rather than talked down, I would suspect. Scotland's the first developed country ever to make a financial contribution to this commitment. Presiding Officer, it's a truly groundbreaking, and it's a testament to 30 years of hard campaigning by the Global South and civil society, which had until now been ignored by northern countries. It's also testament to how our nation always punches above our weight when it comes to taking responsibility. Ironically and cruelly, the countries bearing the brunt of the worst consequences of climate damage are the least responsible for global warming, and we recognise that. So in Scotland, we're making great progress on areas of devolved responsibility, but urgent action from the UK government is critical to meeting our ambitious climate change targets in Scotland. The Scottish Government motion calls for a coalition of action to be formed ahead of COP28, and I support that wholeheartedly. We can't continue to wait year on year for pledges to be made and often broken. And make no mistake, rich developed countries have a moral obligation to support those experiencing the impacts of the climate crisis in the here and now. The total funding Scotland has announced may seem a small sum in terms of the overall scale of the loss and damage that developing countries face, but it sends an important message, and it shows just how important the action of smaller governments can be. And of course, there's a lot of detail to be worked out over the next year, but from the inclusion of loss and damage on the agenda to the agreement to establish a fund, this has been a real breakthrough for vulnerable and developing countries. Presiding Officer, the fact that COP27 was held in Egypt rightly focused on the human rights obligations in every country, and in a similar vein to the World Cup in Qatar right now, a light has been shone on the host country's less than perfect record, and that can only be a good thing. Gender inequalities are exacerbated by the effects of climate change, and I'm pleased that a co-designed approach with women experiencing climate-related harm, coupled with this funding, will seek to tackle the disproportionate impacts of climate change felt by women and girls, and a package of measures to strengthen the role of women from the Global South in the climate action was announced at COP27 by the Scottish Government. It will ensure that more women from the Global South can attend and influence crucial climate negotiations, including next year's COP20 in Dubai, and it will give women human rights defenders from the Global South the opportunity to spend several months in Scotland, where they can continue their work in a place of safety. Presiding Officer, a few months ago I watched a BBC documentary called Big Oil versus the World, and I highly recommend it to everyone who cares about our planet and who hasn't watched it. I think it's still available on Catch Up. But a warning, it will make you angry. It made me very angry as I watched in disbelief at how for the last 50 years, half a century, oil company bosses ignored scientists and dismissed claims of the damage being done to the planet, all in the name of vested interest and greed. What legacy have we left our young people and future generations? During school visits, climate change is the number one topic, and I'm ashamed that my generation has let them down and caused them this concern. Young people from some of the countries already facing the worst impacts of climate change were given the opportunity to attend COP27 in Egypt as part of the Scottish Government's work to widen access to climate negotiations. It's vitally important that countries recommit themselves to doing everything they can to ensure to keep 1.5 alive and to build a coalition ahead of COP20 that protects and drives progress against any further pushback. Scotland believes that all levels of government, in particular where responsibilities are devolved, have a central part to play to deliver the transformative actions needed to halt biodiversity loss across the coming decades. And the Edinburgh Declaration is Scotland's call to state parties to hear the voices of over 280 signatories at COP15 in Montreal. We need them to take stronger actions and make bolder decisions in the next decade. Scotland is a country at the forefront of renewable energy and a just transition away from oil and gas. And that transition is exemplified by Scotland's offshore wind industry, with ScotWind representing the world's largest commercial round for floating offshore wind. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, we can and we must do so much more if we are to save our planet for future generations, and I'm confident that Scotland will do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McKay. And I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for this opportunity to reflect on the cause of climate justice, the legacy of COP26 and the discussion that have recently taken place at COP27 in Egypt. I was glad to be able to meet with many representatives and delegations from around the world at COP26 in Glasgow last year. I had a fruitful discussion with the Bangladeshi delegation about the challenges facing Bangladesh and the way in which Scotland and countries in the Global South can work together on climate change. This includes using Scottish technology and expertise to assist in climate mitigation. This is increasingly important for countries like Bangladesh and Pakistan, both of which have seen devastating floods this year. Weather events which only 20 years ago might have been considered once in a generation or 100 years are now being seen every year. The need for the accelerated timetable of the conference is shown by the accelerated progress of climate disaster around the world. I will return to the theme of mitigation shortly, but I first want to look at COP27 itself. The parties have finally reached an agreement on a loss and damage fund. The work on this, which began in Glasgow last year, acknowledges internationally what has been an obvious truth to many participants for years, namely the countries who contributed the least to the climate change are the ones now being largely affected by the climate change's devastating impact. We should not underestimate the importance of this acknowledgement. It is the necessary starting point for climate justice. Through this framework, loss and damage can be calculated and mitigation can be funded across the world. It is a big step, but it is not the only step needed for climate justice. I'm sure that there are arguments yet to come about the amount that is in the pot and the time it will take to release funding to countries in need. And there is another truth that runs parallel to the one I have just mentioned. The Global North has benefited greatly from the fossil fuels that have caused this damage and is now in the best place for a green transition as a result. So the other hand of climate justice must be to ensure that the countries of the Global South are not locked out of this transition and have access to renewable themselves. Unfortunately, I fear this part of the climate justice is in danger of being lost. Despite all the progress on loss and damage we see in COP27, we see no further progress on phasing out fossil fuels. And I fear that without that other side, we will never know the true climate justice. We will simply be asking the Global North to subsidize the Global South while it makes the same mistakes. This is where the issues of climate mitigation come back into play. We must now take mitigation incredibly seriously, because in the absence of agreement on reducing fossil fuels, it will be more necessary than ever before. When we see the scale of the damage caused by this year's floods, we get an idea of what we might be facing in the future. Climate refugees already exist, but their numbers might become greater than we dare to imagine if we do not take mitigation effort seriously. The cross-party group on Bangladesh recently heard that there could be as many as 18 million climate refugees from Bangladesh in coming decades if the worst climate effects are realized. That is the equivalent of the population of the Netherlands becoming refugees. We are fooling ourselves if we do not think such a large flows of people from climate hit regions will have a significant impact on the rest of the world. It is in all our interest that this does not happen. This means a relentless focus on climate mitigation. But it also means reducing fossil fuels and allowing the Global South to have its own part in the Green Revolution. I greatly hope that COP28 regains this focus on reducing fossil fuels for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Tewtree. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the NZEC Committee, I'm happy to speak in this debate today on the varied outcomes of COP27. COP27 will go down in history as the UN Climate Change Conference where the Loss and Damage Fund was agreed. After decades of pushing, this is a momentous victory for the climate-vulnerable developing countries. The shift in the conversation and in the position of developed countries since COP26 is remarkable. COP27 has finally seen an acknowledgement by developed countries that the people least responsible for global warming are the ones suffering its worst consequences. Crucially, it also recognises that rich developed nations have a moral obligation to support those experiencing the impacts of the climate crisis in the here and now. And there remains a lot of detail to be worked out over the next year ahead of COP28. But from the inclusion of loss and damage on the agenda to the agreement to establish a fund, this COP has delivered a real breakthrough for vulnerable and developing countries. By working with others over the last 12 months to build the momentum, Scotland should be proud to play its part leading up to this decision. It is crucial that parties continue to build on the positive momentum created in Sharm, as challenging discussions on how the new Loss and Damage Fund will work and who will contribute to it financially ensue. Presiding Officer, Scotland, in being the first developed country ever to make a financial contribution, has been able to play a small part in the loss and damage journey. Last year, Scotland was the first developed nation to pledge finance to address loss and damage, with a commitment at COP26 of £2 million from the Climate Justice Fund. Other countries like Wallonia and Denmark have now followed suit, and we should all be encouraging all economically developed nations to do similar. An additional £5 million of funding was announced by the First Minister at the COP27 Climate Summit, taking the total funding Scotland has announced to £7 million. And while a small sum in terms of the overall scale of the loss and damage that developing countries face, it does send out an important international message. It shows just how important the action of smaller governments can be in making a huge difference internationally and in encouraging others to do so. In virtually everything we do on loss and damage, Scotland is trying to ensure that we listen to international perspectives, especially the perspectives of the Global South. While the action of Scotland and our European neighbours is vitally important and indeed has been recognised as being by the likes of the United Nations, COP27 was a hectic and sometimes chaotic event. The COP advanced some matters, but on others failed to drive ambitions towards the sort of climate action required to keep alive the possibility of restricting climate change within the envelope of the Paris Agreement to 1.5 degrees. Loss and damage progressed, but especially in week two, the risk was of going backwards in this COP relative to COP26 in Glasgow. The final cover declaration managed to avoid the worst, but it also avoided the best. Notably disappointing was that the recognition of loss and damage has not been matched by greater action to prevent a worsening of the climate crisis. Keeping 1.5 alive and delivering the fastest possible transition away from fossil fuels is key to preventing greater loss and damage in the future. It is vitally crucial that countries recommit themselves to doing everything they can to ensure we keep 1.5 alive and to building a coalition ahead of COP28 that protects and drives progress against any further pushback. While discussing COP27, it would be remiss of me not to mention the other COP, the Biodiversity COP15, which will begin in Montreal tomorrow. Climate change and nature loss are twin crises, and both must be tackled together. The Scottish Government recognises this and has shown international leadership through the Edinburgh Declaration to highlight the crucial role that sub-nation and local government can play in protecting nature. Scotland has suffered from high historic levels of nature loss, and we face huge challenges today. Nearly 50% of species have decreased in abundance since 1994, and one in nine species are at a risk of national extinction. It is expected that COP15 will result in a new global framework to tackle biodiversity loss, with a draft target to protect 30% of land and sea for nature by the end of the decade, known as the 30 by 30 target. The Scottish Government has already committed to implementing the 30 by 30 target in Scotland. Research conducted by Servation found that two-thirds of Scots support this target. And a report published this week by the Coalition Scottish Environment Link underlined how important 30 by 30 can be. The report said that protected areas are the front line of defence for nature against growing pressures from human activity and climate change and are vital for supporting our species and habitats. Presiding Officer, in closing, we have a climate emergency. Scotland is doing what we can to tackle that emergency, but we need to see a greater effort from the international community, and I ask the Government to continue to press for this action. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. After COP27, the odds are now sadly stacked against keeping the world to 1.5 degrees of heating. And the UN Secretary General described the latest IPCC report as an atlas of human suffering. This is what we now face. This is what is now completely inevitable. But that threat should really galvanise us, because even if 1.5 degrees is now dead, then we must redouble our efforts to keep hope and progress alive. And it will not be enough to have short-term technical decarbonisation plans that allow business as usual to simply continue. We need a revolution in our thinking as well, to look forward to future generations with every action that we take, because the footprints we leave today will last for generations to come. And it is time, I think, to join the dots and see the connections between what is already happening to our world. Europe is currently heating at twice the rate of the rest of the planet, while the Arctic is heating three times faster, and every fraction of a degree of Arctic temperature increase has seen a more erratic polar jet stream, bringing heat waves, droughts, forest fires, and excess deaths across Europe. A melting Arctic permafrost could be game over for this planet. If the tipping point is reached, then 25 to 40% of global carbon budgets could be blown just by permafrost emissions alone. We are one people living on one planet with a shared history and a shared future. And what happens in the Arctic writes the future of a community in Bangladesh. And that's why it is so important that COP27 finally took a critical step forward towards climate reparations for nations at the front line of this crisis, with that dedicated fund established for loss and damage. But as the conference came to a close, we saw that the progress made in Glasgow start to wither away without delivering the necessary commitments on a phase out from all fossil fuels. And despite the leadership of Alok Sharma at COP27 and his calls for a phase out of all fossil fuels, the Westminster government have continued largely with business as usual, despite continuous calls from the International Energy Agency that, in their words, there can be no new investments in oil, coal and gas. We have seen a disastrous expansion of oil and gas licences in the North Sea, and potentially even permission being granted this week for a new mega coal mine in the north of England. We cannot drill our way out of either the energy cost crisis or the climate emergency. The answer to both of those is rapid transition away from oil and gas that delivers for both workers and the planet. Now, COP26 showed us that when small nations work together, that they can lead the world on climate justice. That is exactly the message that the launch of the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance sent when a flotilla of countries joined together to plan for a fair and fast phase out of fossil fuels. Chile, Fiji and Washington were amongst the newest members to join the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance and commit to fossil fuel phase out dates at COP27. And I expect this government's programme of work in understanding our own energy requirements in Scotland will lead us to joining this growing network of climate leaders. But it's also crucial that the Scottish Government continues the dialogue with Westminster to join the rising international calls for collective withdrawal from the Energy Charter Treaty, which is now clearly beyond reform. Fossil fuel companies should not be allowed to sue governments for hundreds of millions of pounds if they introduce policies that limit the use of coal, oil and gas in line with climate ambitions. If there's time in hand.
You'd have to accommodate it within 6 minutes.
The biodiversity COP starting this week underlines the climate and nature crises are two sides of the same coin. And in Scotland, rising temperatures have threatened some of our most iconic species. And the very habitats that can help us naturally capture and store carbon from the atmosphere, like peatlands, are now under threat, causing them to release the carbon they hold. So I look forward to the forthcoming Scottish biodiversity strategy starting to address these twin crises head on. Now, there is much in the Scottish Government's programme for government that has put us on a faster route to net zero, from an ambitious heat and building strategy to free bus travel for under 22s, which we found out today is now benefiting over 500,000 young Scots, a surge in tree planting, a new deal for wind power. However, no government is currently going far enough. And the UK CCC and the Scottish Climate Assembly have both highlighted the need for faster and more radical change, especially in the areas of aviation, peatland restoration and diet change. And I'm sure, like other members, that there will be further challenges from the UK CCC when they release their Scotland Update report tomorrow. But the challenging and necessary target set by this Parliament will mean that a far more ambitious climate plan must be developed early next year. The current plan is already way out of date. It doesn't reflect the ambitions of the Butte House Agreement, and no option should be off the table in developing the new climate plan. The leadership, for example, shown by the French government this week in banning domestic flights where there is a rail alternative, signals the kind of options which need to be considered if we're truly to deliver. Whether we currently have the powers or not is a different question, but what is necessary must be spelled out. So, Presiding Officer, it's clear that an outdated business-as-usual model will lead us down a road of no return. And I'll keep working as a member of the NZ Committee and with Greens in Government to ensure that Scotland delivers the transformative action
thank
on
you,
climate
Mr. Ruscott.
Nature
I did
that we
say we are
need.
Out of time. I now call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Brian Whittle. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. And after the anticipation and build-up to COP27, the biggest climate meeting of the year is now over. The crowds of delegates that thronged the Sharm el-Sheikh International Convention Centre for 2 long weeks have all headed home to recover. many fatigued from long hours and sleepless nights as negotiators tried to seal a deal that would move the world forwards. However, the crucial question is whether COP27 was a success. Presiding officer, first, the not so good. Many consider that COP27 did not reach what the science is telling us we desperately need. With the window of opportunity closing fast on the world's goal of limiting global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees or less, there is agreement that COP27 did far too little on the all-important issue of mitigation, the urgent need to cut global emissions. The case for urgent action keeps getting stronger. The latest reports from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change make for grim reading about what to expect if we let temperatures rise too much. The head of the key negotiating group of developing countries was Pakistan, which has been dealing with the worst floods in its history, leaving 1,717 people dead and costing an estimated $40 billion in damage. In 2022, In the US, there were 15 climate-related disasters which each exceeded $1 billion in costs. Meanwhile, in Africa, according to Carbon Brief's analysis of disaster records, extreme weather events have killed at least 4,000 people and affected a further 19 million since the start of 2022. The pressure was therefore on at COP27 to respond to such disasters. Attending COP27 were 112 world leaders and over 300 government ministers, something like 27,000 people from governments, intergovernmental agencies, stakeholders and journalists also attended. This was to the backdrop of the UN Secretary General warning us that we needed to cooperate or perish, to take urgent action to take us off a highway to climate hell. This is really serious warning from the UN, a warning underpinned by global scientific evidence, and we need to listen to it. And yet, in the face of our global climate emergency, progress on mitigation was modest at best. While some delegations pushed hard for stronger commitments on cutting emissions, the appetite from some nations, mainly the large emitting nations, did not seem to be present. I therefore ask the Scottish Government to do all it can to redouble its efforts to lead by example in pressing for global action on climate mitigation and on reaching the 1.5 degree target. Presiding officer, there were, however, significant advances at COP27. Perhaps most so was the agreement to create a loss and damage fund to help the most vulnerable countries. This has been a key issue for almost 30 years, particularly for small island developing countries. I am proud that it was Scotland at COP26 that started things off, with a voluntary contribution of $2 million for loss and damage. The additional announcement from the First Minister of an extra $5 million to help the nations most impacted by the implications of climate change is, of course, welcome. More recently, Denmark, Austria, New Zealand and Belgium have also made financial commitments to loss and damage, now amounting to $244.5 million. This makes the final outcome all the more welcome. The door is now open for the most vulnerable countries to receive more support. A goal has now been set to fully operationalise the fund at COP28 in a year's time. For Scotland's part, the funding for loss and damage will enable communities to take direct action to address the impact of climate. However, we must ensure this funding works as is expected. The following five steps are critical. Quantification, the first thing to decide is how much countries will receive in loss and damage. The funds must assess accumulated damages and accumulated losses over a specific baseline. Assessment, how will loss and damage be assessed, both quantitatively and non-quantitatively? The funding must take account of Indigenous cultural heritage and loss of national and local ecosystems. Attribution. Countries must be supported to monitor and spell out attribution clearly. Disentangling unfolding impacts from past disaster events or other slow processes and natural factors such as salinisation and loss of biodiversity must be considered. Payment monitoring. A fund needs to be capitalised, it needs to be managed. Once the mechanics of the fund have been determined, we need an impact monitoring system. And finally, evaluation and optimisation. Lessons should be learned from existing climate funds to channel private finance towards low-carbon investments. I would welcome a commitment from the Minister that our funding in Scotland will meet these important principles as set out by the UN. Presiding Officer, in closing, the steps the Scottish Government is taking are crucial. We are leading by example in the face of the global climate emergency, but the world must follow suit. I ask the Scottish Government to do all it can in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Katie Clark. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I am delighted to have the opportunity to speak on COP27, the climate and biodiversity crisis, and the response of the Scottish Government to those crises. The previous COPs, most of the focus has been on getting big emitters to commit to emission reduction. In Glasgow last year, the COP26 president said that the target of no more than 1.5 degrees of global warming was still alive, but the pulse was weak. A prominent talking point at COP27, of course, was the viability of that 1.5 degree target. So let's talk about targets, those ambitious targets set by the Scottish Government and voted through by this Parliament. I want to talk about biodiversity, which is often the poor relation in climate change, but every bit is important in our bid to tackle climate change. Now, I've used this figure in the Chamber before. Scotland ranks 212th out of 240 nations assessed for the quality of our nature via biodiversity intactness. We know that when we manage biodiversity, that increased carbon sequestration follows because a healthy environment is a productive environment, especially in terms of biodiversity and the economy. The State of Nature Scotland 2019 report found that the overall abundance and distribution of Scotland's species have declined, including in the last 10 years, and the pressures that drive biodiversity loss are collectively continuing to have a negative impact on nature. The report says, and I quote, there has been no let-up in the net loss of nature in Scotland, despite the Scottish Government's target to halt nature loss by 2030. Yeah. Targets are not enough. Action is required. The SNP Green Coalition have presided over a species decline, including 531 habitats and 603 species in Scotland being in poor condition. And I'm going to use an example here. I'm going to use a marine example because we often forget that the marine environment is actually at least as important in tackling climate change and biodiversity decline. Blue Marine Foundation suggests that the West of Scotland cod population has already declined by 92% since 1991. 12 breeding seabird species have declined in abundance by an average of 38% between 1986 and 2016. So what do we need to do to reverse that trend? Well, we need investment. We certainly need private investment. A key role the government plays in the market is signalling to investors. The Scottish Government can grandstand all they like about how we need to progress towards net zero, but if the Scottish Government are not delivering on their statutory targets, then this does not signal positively to investors to stick their financing where we most need it. The Scottish Government have missed three annual emissions reduction targets in a row and were only successful in meeting the 2020 target due to the travel restrictions related to the temporary COVID-19 pandemic. An analysis of COP27 by Institutional Shareholder Services echoed this confusion that many businesses are experiencing regarding investment into net zero and net zero policies, stating, and again I quote, by demonstrating a lack of credible commitment to their pledges, governments are sending conflicting signals to investors who may conclude that they should scale back their own ambitions and focus on adaptation instead. Now, Liam Kerr raised the issue of the oil and gas sector, and it is something of much debate in here. And it should be said that the International Panel on Climate Change AR6 report sets out that for temperature rises to be kept within that 1.5 degrees, global oil must decrease by 60% and gas by 45% by 2050. And I would note here they don't advocate for the end of fossil fuel entirely, but I do think that they need a consistent reduction by 2050. And, of course, the target should be to eliminate fossil fuels entirely. But this needs to be done in a gradual and sensible way that ensures we protect jobs and deliver a real future for the energy sector and the North East. To do this, we need to actively and transparently engage with the fossil fuel sector, encourage them to move faster and invest more in the renewable sector rather than meeting them with demands or constantly trying to shame them. That is not how you deliver tangible working relationships, a fact I think is completely lost with the SNP Green government. The International Panel on Climate Change ASX report is also clear that fossil fuels, as we reduce fossil fuels, we need to replace them with widespread electrification, improved energy efficiency and use of alternative fuels such as hydrogen. The Scottish Government needs a comprehensive energy plan that includes smart and targeted investment, not scattered investment where the level of investment does not have any real impact, and it needs to get rid of the red tape and release funds to those companies at the forefront of emerging technology, or we risk losing the great opportunities that Scotland has to drive a global green economy. These could be hydrogen, solar or nuclear, and the Scottish Government does have to review its blinkered and blanket objection to the potential of nuclear energy. Our current significant investment into wind does leave us vulnerable if the wind does not blow. The Climate Change Committee suggests that action to address the rising cost of living should be aligned with net zero. These remain an urgent need for equivalent action to reduce demand for fossil fuels, to reduce emissions and limit energy bills. And then I wanted to talk quickly about net zero housing. As was reported in the Herald 3 days ago, the co-leader for the Scottish Greens and Minister for Housing told the Herald that Scotland is making the switch to heating buildings without relying on fossil fuels, that will need a cost of £33 billion too late. Now, obviously, he is right, but he's not the right person to lead this, given that his party don't exactly embrace the private sector. Now, I will conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, to suggest it's not enough to have ambition. We must have an action plan with measurable and accountable targets that address the scale of the crisis we are facing. The Scottish Government needs to stop lecturing the rest of the world and focus on delivery and our part to drive the drive to keep 1.5 alive. And finally, targets without outcomes are just hot air. If we miss the targets, then 1.5 degrees will be missed. The Scottish Government needs to allow Scotland to demonstrate what can be achieved rather than talk about what could be achieved.
Thank you, Mr.
Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And now call Casey Clark to be followed by Paul McLennan. We have no time in hand. Speeches of 6 minutes, please, Ms. Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are in the midst of an emergency. It may well be now probably too late to keep 1.5 alive. But that means even more than ever, we need unprecedented and coordinated action from governments. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change said that without immediate and deep emissions reductions across all sectors, it will be impossible to contain average global temperatures rises to 1.5% above pre-industrial levels. They said that last year, and unfortunately, there is no sign that those deep emission reductions are taking place. Scotland has, of course, repeatedly failed to meet our own annual targets. The commitment at COP27 to give formal recognition to the fact of loss and damage as a result of the climate emergency and to establish a fund under the United Nations Framework Convention of Climate Change is, of course, a positive and overdue step, because it's widely accepted that those most acutely affected by the impacts of the climate emergency have contributed the least to the climate emergency. And I welcome the Scottish Government's pledge of £2 million to loss and damage through the Climate Justice Fund. However, I have absolutely no doubt that the ministers accept that the amount committed is not a true reflection of the climate damage created by Scotland's past or indeed present emissions, that this sum is mainly symbolic, and that this must only be the start of a sustained and focused long-term commitment to ensure that governments, and indeed governments at both a UK and a Scottish level, deliver for climate vulnerable countries by ensuring commitments on adaptation and loss, and that damage is honoured. We know that between 1988 and 2015, an estimated 100 companies producing fossil fuels excluding agricultural methane, were responsible for 71% of all global emissions. These companies are overwhelmingly based in the so-called global north. These injustices only compound the long history of colonisation and oppression many of these countries have suffered. And Fawzal Chowdhury spoke knowledgeably using his own experience and indeed his involvement in the cross-party group on Bangladesh about that. Whilst the government is right to express disappointment in their motion in relation to lack of action, I think it is also appropriate in this place that we talk about the Scottish Government's own lack of action on this issue. The Scottish Government's own energy strategy has noted that there are significant opportunities in the North Sea with up to 20 billion barrels of oil equivalent remaining. I take on board the point made that it's about whether those oil barrels are burnt, but in October, when I asked the Cabinet Secretary to make a clear public stance against the proposed Rosebank oilfield development, his response was that the Scottish Government's opposition to Rosebank was conditional, that it should be subject to a rigorous climate compatibility checkpoint to ensure that it's consistent with emissions reductions targets. This simply isn't good enough. We need to address fossil fuel production and deliver local renewable production, particularly through municipal and community production. But at a Scottish level, we also need to look at initiatives such as that proposed by Colin Smith and indeed proposed in the Scottish Labour motion of a publicly owned energy company. I will.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Just to clarify, the advice and the position which the Scottish Government has taken on new oil and gas production on a compatibility checkpoint is in line with the independent advice that we've received from the Committee on Climate Change, who have said that there should be a rigorous, robust climate compatibility checkpoint before any production is taken forward. Can I just clarify whether the Labour Party support the position of the Committee on Climate Change, or whether their position is that there should be absolutely no new oil and gas developments, end of?
Ms. Katie Clark.
I've got very limited time, so I won't be able to give the Minister a full response, but I think the Minister is very well aware of the scale of the challenge and that we cannot carry on like this and that we cannot continue to extract oil and gas in the way that we have. The International Energy Agency has repeatedly stated that rejecting any new oil or gas developments are a bare minimum requirement if the world wants to reach net zero emissions by 2050. And we're going in the wrong direction, and I hope that the Scottish Government will accept that. A Friends of the Earth report last year found North Sea oil production had increased 15% since the climate emergency had declared. We need to take radical action. People and planet demand more urgent action, and I look forward, unfortunately I've not been able to respond to the Minister fully due to lack of time, and I'm now over time, but I hope that in the debates that take place in this place that we agree more radical action for the future.
Thank you, Ms Clark. And I now call Paul McLennan, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Greenhouse gas emissions keep growing. Global temperatures keep rising, and our planet is fast approaching tipping points that will make climate chaos irreversible. We are on a highway to climate hell with our foot on accelerator. Antonio Guterres, Secretary-General of the United Nations. There can be no effective climate policy without the peace. There are still too many for whom climate change is just rhetoric or marketing, but not real action. They are the ones who start wars of aggression when the planet can't afford a single gunship because it needs global joint action. Volodymyr Zelensky, President of Ukraine. That's the global context of COP27. This was the first UN climate summit in the Global South for 6 years. COP27 was billed as the implementation COP, where rhetoric would be turned into action, particularly in terms of support for countries on the front lines of the crisis. COP27 did not deliver on these expectations. To say nothing of what is needed to stop complete climate breakdown, it did secure some important wins, in particular a loss and damage fund and a renewed emphasis on equity. We still need the world to agree a new long-term goal for climate finance and whether so-called emissions removals and avoidance will be allowed to be traded in Paris Agreement carbon markets. On loss and damage, the securing of the loss and damage fund to address the now unavoidable impacts of climate change was a huge win for the Global South countries who made this their priority issue at COP27. COP27 has seen acknowledgement, finally, by developed countries that the people at least responsible for global warming are the ones suffering its worst consequences. There was considerable resistance from wealthy historical polluters to establishing this fund, with those countries promoting technical assistance and deeply inadequate insurance schemes instead. The Scottish Government played an important role in championing a loss and damage fund, and civil society campaigning was key in securing this vital win. But working with others over the last 12 months to build momentum, Scotland should be proud to play its part leading up to this decision. Secretary-General Antonio Guterres said of Scotland, "Scotland is one of the first international actors that has determined money for loss and damage. That is a very important point for developing countries, and so I would like to say how much I appreciate the Scottish effort in this regard." And on keeping 1.5C alive, it's deeply disappointing that the recognition of loss and damage has not been matched by greater action to prevent the worsening of the climate crisis. Despite 26 years of UN climate negotiations, emissions are still rising. And despite all the hype around about keeping 1.5 alive at the Glasgow summit last year, the world is on course for 2.8 rise or more. In recognition of this, countries were asked to voluntarily update their pledges to cut emissions ahead of COP27. Updated pledges reduce emissions in 2030 by only 1%. 1%. And despite leading the calls on this as outgoing president of COP26, the UK Government failed to increase its own commitments. The next official round of nationally determined contributions, NDCs, pledges, climate action pledges under the Paris Agreement, are not due until 2030. That's another 8 years away, far too late to stop climate breakdown. Analysis of Paris Agreement pledges showed that the rich historical polluters are not doing anywhere near enough their fair share of climate action based on remaining carbon budgets and UNFCCC principles of equity and common but differentiated responsibility, with many Global South countries committed to undertaking their fair share or more of the action. Rich polluters are gambling with the high stakes imaginable and running down the clock on 1.5 by failing to cut their own emissions in line with their own obligations and failing to deliver their financial obligations. They are shifting the responsibility once more onto the shoulders of countries who have done the least to cause a problem and are on the front line of impacts. 2 weeks ago, I spoke in the members' debate on the Fraser Valander, the economic impact of Scotland's renewable energy sector. Scotland's renewable energy industry and its supply chain support more than 27,000 full-time equivalent jobs and generate £5.6 billion of input in 2020. Onshore wind has the largest input, generating nearly £2.5 billion, with offshore and hydro both supporting more than £1.1 billion output together. The Scottish Government will soon be unveiling its energy strategy and just transition strategy. These will be ambitious and move us towards net zero. Scotland needs to continue to develop the existing renewables revolution underway. The supply chain needs to increase the required capacity to deliver skills and manufacturing to service all our renewable energy projects. With a short-term offshore wind pipeline of 6.9 gigawatts and a potential of more than 10 gigawatts of onshore wind, the existing pipeline of renewable energy projects to be delivered in Scotland is extensive. President Officer, I want to close with two other quotes from COP27. This is from William Ruto, President of Kenya. In the face of impending catastrophe, whose warning signs are already unbearably disastrous, weak action is unwise. No action is dangerous. And the final one is from Ursula von der Leyen, President of the European Commission. The global fossil fuel crisis must be a game changer. So let's not just take the highway to hell, but let's earn a clean ticket to heaven. The stakes couldn't be any higher. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McLennan. We will now move to closing speeches, and I call Mercedes Bialba to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Bialba.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have this opportunity to close the debate on COP27 outcomes for Labour, because climate change is an issue that I am passionate about tackling. Like poverty, climate change is an issue of inequality, of injustice, which hits working class people hardest and which is caused by political choices that benefit and have benefited the super rich. So, in closing for Labour today, it gives me the opportunity to summarise and to reiterate our position in this debate. But before I do so, I'd like to spend some time commenting on the Scottish Government's motion and on the amendment put forward by the Conservative Party. So, while I have to say I think it's a stretch too far to claim, as Gillian Martin seemed to, that there would be no outcomes from COP27 if Scotland's First Minister hadn't been there, there is much within the motion from the government which Labour are supporting today. It's fair to say that the Loss and Damage Fund is an important step forward in tackling climate change and challenging the injustice of climate change. As my colleague Faisal Chowdhury highlighted, global inequality, the global inequality of how those whose economies have benefited most from fossil fuels have had relatively little impact compared to those whose resources have been exploited, not just in the recent past, but also throughout the long history of colonialism, as highlighted by my colleague Katie Clark. We see time and again that those who are most acutely impacted by the climate emergency have contributed the least to climate change. So it's right that we tackle this injustice, and it's right that we have that we seek to address through the Loss and Damage Fund. Labour also supports within the government's motion the sentiment around the phase down of unabated coal use and other fossil fuels, and to ensuring that human rights are fully respected, and to protect on human rights. Can I get the time back?
No, but
I'm afraid I'm not able to take the intervention. Sorry, Mark. And we also support the ambition of protecting 30% of land and seas by 2030, but targets are not enough when tackling the climate and nature emergencies. We need to see action, and we need to see delivery, as our amendment highlights. We will not be supporting the Tory amendment today because it removes crucial lines on the transition away from fossil fuels. That's not to say that there isn't that we don't support the sentiment, as we did with the Scottish Government motion around human rights and protecting human rights right across the world. And I was pleased to see that in the Conservative Party's amendment today. The Conservative Party, we've heard today from Liam Kerr, they say that they want a just transition, like all of us want a just transition. But I suppose the question that I always have when I hear Conservative members speaking about a just transition is, a just transition for who? Will it be for ordinary workers and householders through a green industrial strategy that invests in public services? Or are they talking about a just transition for private corporations, for oil multinationals seeking to protect their profits? I'm afraid I don't have time in hand. But as I've said, there is an element of the amendment that we support around protecting human rights across the world. And there have been elements from today's debate which we would support, thinking back to comments from Graham Simpson around having lower bus fares for all, dualling train tracks, and I think I'm sure he'll correct me if I'm wrong, I think I heard him propose that we offer free ferry travel to under 22s who live on the islands. These kind of investments into our communities, in public services, are things that Labour support and that we'd like to see more of. I'd be interested to hear if their colleagues in Westminster will support these kind of proposals. In my final minute, I'd like to move to Labour's amendment. So we have taken the decision to support the government's motion and to add an amendment of our own on the end, and I hope the government will be able to support our amendment, because I think it's important that we have on the record an acknowledgement that we are not in Scotland currently meeting our own annual targets to cut emissions, despite the fact that we're very well placed to do so. If we had a socialist Green New Deal that used every lever to redistribute wealth through job creation in a suite of new public services, we could drastically reduce our emissions in this country. A public energy company which would generate renewable energy would also provide a low cost to consumers and sectoral collective bargaining for workers. Likewise, council-run bus companies would lower the cost to consumers and improve workers' rights to the workers involved. We have heard often from the government that these kind of policies are not possible because of the fixed budget. I think we heard this argument crumble.
Ms. Bialba, you've got 5 seconds left.
Okay. I think basically it's not good enough for the government to say that we don't have the power or the wealth or the skills. We have all of those things. The only thing we don't have is a government with the socialist ambition to redistribute wealth and power. So that's why we need a workers' economy, which only Labour and government can deliver.
Thank you, Ms. Bialba, you're for your time. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I now call on Maurice Golden to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a welcome opportunity for Parliament to discuss climate change, something it does not do nearly enough, in my opinion. I'm going to begin today by highlighting some of the important contributions that we have heard this afternoon. I think there's consensus on tackling climate change and tackling it faster. The Cabinet Secretary highlighted that this is a global challenge, that we work together as a global community with a shared sense of urgency, and described the COP27 agreement as a watershed agreement. Liam Kerr pointed to a lot of talk domestically and not enough action and said, we all agree we want a just transition. Graeme Simpson on transport primarily described the fact that moving people from petrol and diesel cars requires infrastructure, and that last month, in terms of moving to those electric cars, just 8 out of the target 4,000 chargers were put in place. So a considerable amount of a shortfall there. Colin Smith described the possibility of the catastrophic 2.8 degree rise and flagged the major sectors that we need to take action in, and I should at this point say we'll be supporting the Labour amendment today. Alex Cole-Hamilton described a need for radical and credible policies. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to take my intervention where I was going to ask him where he thought the Scottish Government policies were in that category. He also mentioned that insulating fuel-poor houses could take up to 300 years. Audrey Nicol highlighted that COP27 was a beginning of a difficult process, and we had further contributions along those lines from Rona Mackay, Jackie Dunbar and Colette Stevenson. And finally, Mark Ruskell talked about the being stacked against the world to keeping to 1.5 degrees and that we need some revolutionary thinking. But Deputy Presiding Officer, the threat posed by climate change is more pressing than ever. And according to the IPCC, approximately 40% of the world's population is highly vulnerable to climate change impacts. In Pakistan, catastrophic floods submerged a third of the country, killed over 1,700 people and damaged or destroyed 2 million homes, a point made by Faisal Chowdhury, who also referenced Bangladesh. In Europe, the World Health Organization estimates at least 15,000 deaths from heat waves this year, heat waves caused by temperatures that will be, and I quote, virtually impossible without climate change, according to the World Weather Attribution Group. In Scotland, we could see heat-related deaths rise by more than 100 per year by 2050. They also say we could expect homes and businesses to be damaged more frequently and as a result of severe flooding. So it concerns everyone if efforts to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees fails. To keep that goal viable, there must be a 43% reduction in greenhouse gases by 2030 versus 2019 levels. And it was welcome to see COP27 reaffirm the commitment to the 1.5 degree limit, but frustrating that global ambition to reduce emissions only saw limited progress, according to the UK Committee on Climate Change. Nevertheless, COP27 did give us a glimmer of hope, especially at a national level. More countries signed the Global Methane Pledge, taking the total to 150. India formalised its COP26 pledges. Britain strengthened plans for delivering its 2030 emissions targets. And Mexico, Turkey and Australia increased their 2030 targets. It's also worth noting that Australia follows Britain's lead and set its net zero target in law. COP27, Britain announced more than £100 million to support developing countries dealing with climate change impacts. This includes over £65 million investment in green tech and clean energy in Kenya and Egypt. But I want to say a bit more about adaptation funding, since it was a key issue at COP27. It is estimated that climate change measures could cost developing countries anywhere up to £340 billion a year. So it's significant that there was an agreement to establish a loss and damage fund to address those impacts. But there's still so much to decide. Who pays for the fund, how much, and who will benefit? But that shouldn't distract from the significance of the agreement. COP27 also saw an endorsement of nature-based solutions. Such measures can play an important role in both mitigation and adaptation efforts. For example, the Bahamas is allowing marine conservation projects to sell blue carbon credits, offering an adaptation mechanism generating new revenue and helping to protect local ecosystems. Nature-based solutions are important in Scotland too, but progress is poor. Take peatland. The SNP Green Coalition has a target to restore 20,000 hectares of degraded peatland each year. It's an excellent carbon sink, so we all want it to succeed. But they didn't even manage to restore a quarter of that target last year. Or look at forestry. The Woodland Trust estimates around £500 million is needed to restore and expand Scotland's rainforest. The SNP and Greens have stumped up less than 1% of that. And of course, they've missed their own emissions targets 3 years running, in 2017 and 2018 and 2019. Add to that failures to make legal clean air targets, international biodiversity targets, green jobs targets, recycling targets, which won't be met for 680 years. You've got a catalogue of failures. But if Scotland is to meet its climate goals, the SNP and Greens must start delivering, not just for them, for all of us, and also working with the UK government. That's the lessons from COP, consensus and cooperation.
Thank you, Mr Golden. I now call on Lauren Slater to wind up the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 9 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all members for contributing to this debate today. There is, I think, recognition across this chamber that COP27 was the first COP at which the impact of climate change on vulnerable nations finally received the recognition that was long overdue. While much remains to be decided about the how and the who, the establishment of the Loss and Damage Fund was a genuine success and a rare positive news story. There were undeniable disappointments, in particular the failure to agree and deliver on the action that is needed, unavoidable, if the goal of 1.5 degrees is to remain within reach. There is one area on which all parties agreed, and that is the need for urgency of action. 2022 has seen growing climate-induced extreme weather and disasters, emphasising the immediacy of the threat, not just in Pakistan and East Africa, but to us all. We are code red on climate. Certainly.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister. I wonder if the Minister could provide this chamber with her assessment of the SNP's government's ability to meet their targets prior to 2021, when, of course, she took office.
Minister.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure if the member's asking for historical data or our progress this year, but certainly the government is working very hard on concrete actions to deliver. I mean, examples on the table are our £500 million Just Transition Fund in the Northeast, which is going to projects to create those new jobs and to support that new technology, free bus travel for under 22s, our Nature Restoration Fund, Recycling Improvement Fund. It goes on and on and on. Our commitments to tackling the climate crisis. Certainly.
Dr. Slums.
Thank the Minister for taking an intervention. Does she think that cutting the budget for Marine Scotland will help us meet our climate targets?
Minister.
Thank the member for the intervention. We all know that we have to make sure that our, you know, budget stretches, and that sometimes means difficult decisions. We have to make sure we are getting the best impact for every pound that is spent. Each pound can only be spent once, and the member will know our need to balance our budgets. Just to comment on the amendments today, there are some positive contributions in the Scottish Labour Amendment. We absolutely agree with the need to realise Scotland's potential for renewables and to secure as much of that benefit as possible from this industry for Scotland. But as usual, Labour are ignoring the actual powers of the Scottish Government. Realising our renewables potential must be a joint endeavour, with the UK Government doing their bit too. For example, to ensure proper support is in place for emerging technologies where Scotland could lead, like tidal and reducing connection and transmission costs. Certainly.
Monica Lennon.
Grateful to the Minister for giving way. She'll be aware of Commonweal and their important policy work on democratising energy. Now, there was a commitment from the Greens and the SNP around the public ownership of energy generation. There's been progress in Wales. I just wonder if ministers are speaking to counterparts in the Welsh Government to see where we can learn from that and try and get the action that I think many of us want to see.
Minister.
I thank the member very much for that intervention. I am absolutely aware of what is going on in Wales, and while it's an interesting project, the scale of it is very, very small and would do very little to tackle our renewable energy challenges in Scotland. Mr Kerr makes an important point with his amendment that meeting our targets requires collaboration across our borders. But that means the UK Government has to do its bit too. It means more support for the renewable sector in Scotland through, for example, delivering a fair GB transmission charging regime that enables the rapid growth and deployment of renewables. And it means staying true to their own commitments. Are the Tory government in Westminster really going to consent to a new coal mine in Cumbria, for example? Mr Kerr's amendment also removes the references to the critical COP15 talks that start this week. Addressing the climate and nature crises must go hand in hand. Difficult decisions are ahead if we are to keep 1.5 alive. The knock-on effects of the war in Ukraine, a cost of living crisis driven particularly by energy prices, and the lasting impacts of COVID-19 teach us that we should push forward with our energy transition ambitions if we are to be resilient to global shocks. Certainly. One more.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful and I respect the fact the Minister has taken now four interventions. Just on a point of order, my amendment doesn't remove any reference to COP15. But my intervention, we heard in this debate earlier on about the importance of the ACORN project. The Green Party is on record as being reportedly opposed to carbon capture, utilisation and storage. Does the Minister agree with her party or the government that she's a member of?
Minister.
Thank you very much to the member for the intervention. The Committee on Climate Change does account for the use of CCUS in its calculations. The Scottish Greens and other Green parties are sceptical of the practical implementation of CCUS because some of this technology is untested. Scotland's participation at COP27 and the meetings held with leaders and ministers from multiple continents proved that we have a lot to offer and to learn from others. The huge interest in our just transition to net zero, in particular our expertise in offshore wind and green hydrogen, showed Scotland really is seen as a world leader on these technologies. There is no doubt that Scotland must move away from fossil fuels as quickly as a just transition will effectively and fairly allow. Our highly skilled oil and gas workforce have long been at the forefront of energy innovation, and that is why we see a bright future ahead for a revitalised North Sea economy that drives a net zero energy system, as well as huge employment opportunities for this innovative workforce in the energy transition. Let's be clear, though, that we are still talking about an end date. Unlimited extraction of fossil fuels is fundamentally incompatible with our climate obligations. Ultimately, oil and gas licensing, regulation and taxation is reserved to the UK government. And we need to see more investment in renewables and energy transition from our Westminster colleagues. We have already shown that our actions can move the dial internationally. Loss and damage was a central issue in Egypt, and Scotland has played a small but significant role in this space. The decision to establish a fund is the result of over three decades of hard work by vulnerable nations and small island states. But Scotland's ongoing commitment turned up the pressure on that decision in a way that no developed country had done before. We are acting on a world stage. I will be attending COP15 this week, where I will emphasise the twin crises and the inextricable link between biodiversity loss and climate change. I will launch our new draft biodiversity strategy and, through the Edinburgh process and Edinburgh Declaration, promote adoption of the sub-national plan of action. These actions will showcase nature-based solutions in Scotland and how they are contributing to reducing biodiversity loss, and meeting our net zero target. Our space on the world stage should encourage and motivate our ambitions at home. Scotland's international presence is an opportunity to maximise our impact, to see the change we effect at home multiplied elsewhere. We are a small country, but our efforts can and do influence great global change. I wanted to follow up on the question we had from Liam Kerr about the allocation and spending of the loss and damage fund from Scotland. £1.7 million of the £2 million has been allocated. These funds have been spent and are in use currently in Malawi, the Pacific Islands and Bangladesh. That money is being spent on the ground. The £5 million will be allocated based on community-led needs assessments in consultation with stakeholders experiencing loss and damage, as will monitoring and evaluation. The £5 million loss and damage commitment at COP27 has been committed specifically to address non-economic, slow asset loss and damage, which have so far had insufficient global attention. The £5 million will be allocated and spent according to a four-stage methodology. This methodology has been tested extensively with the global community and was discussed at length at the Loss and Damage Conference that Scotland hosted. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on COP27 outcomes, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business. I'll allow a very short pause to enable members to change position should they wish. Thank you.